National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story. This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greatest sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is a documentary account of the situation in the Pacific, of the men and events which are today influencing world affairs for generations to come. China's Wild Men of the Mountains.
Americans are still living, it is altogether possible they are being held as slaves by the Lolos. I have seen many, many of their slaves in my 30 years as a missionary out here. And I have seen many other things.
Set fire to every house in every village.
Set fire to everything.
Take the Chinese alive. Take them alive.
This was a reprisal raid by the Lolos. The Chinese had killed some Lolos they had caught outside of the Lolo country. After the Lolos had burned down the Chinese villages, they carried away the captive women as slaves and lined up all the captive men and boys.
Kill every Chinese man and boy!
Kill every Chinese man and boy!
Look at this Lolo. You see, he is tall, over 6 feet. He is strong. Look at that aquiline nose and that fine mouth. Notice that he is almost fair in complexion, something like the South Europeans, and that he has clear blue eyes.
This is our country, these mountains.
You see that he wears a heavy felt wrapping, which is his mantle in the daytime and his bed cover at night.
This has been our country for hundreds of years.
The Lolos occupy this mountain country where the provinces of Yunnan and Sichuan and Sikang come together.
Mountaineers are always free men.
Regardez, he wears a small braid of hair that points upward and a coral earring in his left ear.
We are nobles. Bring up my pony.
Yes, yes, Lord. Come on, up.
Over here.
Yes, Lord. Here.
Hold him.
Yes, Lord.
The Lolos are excellent horsemen. You see, they ride strange saddles with high ridge in front, and those small, tough horses they ride like the wind.
Ooh.
He is a Lolo chieftain, or what is called a blackbone. Now, look at this one who brought up his horse. Notice that he is not so large. He is darker. His nose is more hooked. He is a slave, or what they call a white bone. His name is Losang Chindi. Losang Chindi. And he is a slave.
The No Su has nearly 100 white bones like me.
Losang is a second generation slave.
My father and his brother came from Chengdu in Sichuan. They knew about the coal in the copper and the gold here. Until 1906, there was much mining here. Then the Black Bones drove out all the Chinese. They drove out my grandfather. And when my father and uncle were growing up, my grandfather told them about the coal and the copper and other minerals here. My grandfather warned them about the Black Bones and what they did to those who entered this mountain country without permission. But still, my father and my uncle decided to leave Chengdu and come into the Lolo Land here.
This is the second day, Tuchau, and we have not seen one person.
The official at the frontier said we would probably go a long way until we saw anyone.
But this seems to be a well-beaten trail.
You are still thinking of what our father told us, Yulin?
You remember what he said?
Yes, but he always exaggerated.
By this time, we should have seen somebody.
Why do you yield to your fears, Yulin? One of our mules is loaded down with goods to barter with them. Did we not learn that they would barter for nearly anything?
What was that?
What?
Stop the mules. Stop them. Whoa there.
Whoa. Whoa up there. Whoa. I did not hear anything.
I did. Wait.
What do you hear?
I do not know.
Let us get on. Yeah, there.
They are around us somewhere.
Many outsiders have entered this country without harm.
You remember what our father told us they did with the Englishman named Brooks?
Brooks did not come prepared. That is why they killed him.
Lulu! Lulu! Riding down on us!
Well there! Whoa!
He'll hit our lead mule. He's down!
Well there! Stop there, you stop!
Look! There are some more running up the trail behind us!
They took my father and my uncle. They took all that the mules carried, and they made my father and my uncle slaves. They worked them from sunup to sundown. At night in the dark, my father and my uncle talked.
They are barbarians, Yulin.
But they have made us their slaves.
They do not even know how to write, most of them.
No.
They hardly have any written language, and we Chinese have had a written language for thousands of years.
But just the same, we are their slaves.
They will not even let us talk to them. They will not listen.
They consider us beneath them.
Us? We Chinese, who have had culture for centuries, almost none of them can read. All they do is drink that wine of raw corn.
It does not affect them so much that they cannot keep us prisoners.
Ah, prisoners. That wine is vile as rancid curds. And those pipes they are always smoking. Men and women, they are a stench so unholy it makes
some of the women are attractive.
Women smoking stinking pipes.
Did you notice how tall and graceful the women are?
Ah, barbarians.
Some of them have a handsome face.
Handsome.
Those flat turbans they wear on their heads. And those long skirts and flowing flounces.
You have paid close attention to the women.
I have paid close attention to everything.
Especially the women.
I have noticed how they dress. Their short jackets, their metal neckbands and bracelets, and their earrings in both ears.
You know what the other Watsi have told us about the Lolo women.
You mean about what the Black Bones do to those who seek out their women? Yes?
It is far better that we think of how we can get back to Chengdu.
We cannot escape now.
Why can we not escape?
They know every lee of this mountain country. This is our first time in it.
We cannot stay here as slaves of these barbarians.
What are you talking about? You're in the dark.
We're just talking.
About what?
About the mountains.
And about how dark it is.
Not too dark for Lolos. Not too dark for Lolos.
My father and my uncle and the other Watsi, the new Chinese who had been captured, did the lowest work for the Lolo tribe. And whenever they had a chance, my uncle Tu Chau and some of the others talked of how they could escape.
Are you not going with us, Yulin?
No.
Why?
You cannot escape now. If you are caught, you know what they will do with you.
One night, my uncle Tu Chau and the others slipped away into the wind. My father Yulin and the others of the Watsi who did not go were hauled down to the center of the village when my uncle Tu Chow and the other who tried to escape were dragged back. They tied my uncle to a post. Two white bones with heavy whips beat him across the bare back.
Look at him. The blood is coming. He is unconscious. How long are they going to keep whipping him?
Stop the whip now. Stop the whip. Now cut him down. Cut the thong.
So you thought you could escape.
Lying there in a heap.
Now the stones. Stone him.
Stone him.
No, no. You are killing him. You are killing him.
Get back there. Take him. Hold him.
The other Watsi who had seen my uncle and the others who tried to escape, flogged and stoned to death, were herded together so the Black Bone could talk to them.
If you would die, you now know how to die. If you would live, then listen to me. First, to live, give up any thought of ever returning to your home. If you work and prove yourself worthy, I will give you land. You can then raise your own food and have only to give me my share. In time, I will raise you from Watsi to White Bone. And if you are a faithful White Bone, there will be other rewards. Now, go back to your work.
When the Black Bone gave my father land, he worked it. Each season he had to give the Black Bone part of his crop and part of his cattle. He never tried to escape, but worked hard. And after 3 seasons, he was raised from Watsi to White Bone. Then they gave him a White Bone woman to marry. She was a slave like my father, but she was half Lolo and half Chinese. She was my mother. I was born in slavery at the time our Black Bone was in a blood feud.
I remember that blood feud. It was like the other feuds that have been going on among the Lolos for hundreds of years. At first, the Black Bone of Yulin and Loseng Chinli was not involved. A distant relative of theirs, Black Bone, had killed another Lolo in self-defense. The relatives of the dead one then came and killed one of the relatives of the Lolo that had done the killing. They, in turn, killed one of the other family group. And so it went on and on for years, until one of the relatives of Yulin's Black Bone was killed.
Death to the family of the killer!
The excitement grew in our village. Then one day the Black Bone's men rode up to our hut.
Come out, Yulin! I want to talk to you. Come out.
Yes, Lord.
Can you ride a horse?
No, I have never ridden a horse.
You have ridden a mule? You were riding a mule when you were taken.
He was very docile. He walked slowly.
Get on this animal.
Right now?
This instant. Get up there.
Yes, Lord.
Sit more forward in the saddle.
Like this?
Like that, yes. Now. Watsi!
Yes.
Give him his armor and sword.
Yes, Lord. Here they are.
I know nothing about fighting.
Put them on now. The cousin of the Black Bone has been killed.
I have never used a sword.
You will learn how. Now, start your horse. Oh, up! 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 Watsi, start his horse!
Yes, Lord. Hut! Hey, get up there! Hut!
Bring your horse up there, Yulin!
I never saw my father again. He was killed in the fight. My mother worked the land and took care of me. When I was big enough, I worked too. Each season, we took the Black Bone share to him. When the new captive Chinese were brought in, sometimes we talked to them. I asked them questions about Chengdu, where my father came from. They were frightened when they learned what happened to my father and my uncle. When I was 9 years old, my mother became sick. She was sick a long time before we took her to the soothsayer.
You have wronged the god of the soil.
The Lolo soothsayers are priests and doctors and magicians. Yet, really, they are none of these. They are like witch doctors, like sorcerers.
In the smoke of the fire, I can see you have wronged the gods that have given you food, that have given you life.
The soothsayers have great power.
You must try to please our heavenly Buddha.
The Lolos are not really Buddhists. This is a vestige of something that has gone long years ago.
The gods of the earth have paid no heed when you have killed a chicken. They have paid no heed when you have killed a sheep. You have deeply offended the gods. I can see in the smoke. You must now kill a cow.
The cow was the last animal we had. I can remember all the people who came to help us eat the cow. When it was all gone, they went in to see my mother in her bed before they left.
You will be well now, sister.
Soon we will be back in your field again, Chow Kang.
Now you will have health and good fortune, sister.
You have pleased the gods, Chow Kang. You will be strong and prosperous.
That night, my mother died.
So you see, Lo Sang Chingdi is three-quarters Chinese, one-quarter Lolo. He is a white bone, a slave, and can never become a black bone. There are hundreds of thousands like him.
In fact, what is happening
to the Lolos is what has been happening to all peoples who have come in direct contact with the Chinese. They are being absorbed. Lolos migrated centuries ago into the wild highland country in the bend of the upper Yangtze, between the Golsan River and the great snowy mountains along the border of Tibet. They went boldly down into the valleys and captured Chinese by the tens of thousands and brought them back into these mountains as slaves. From the first, they killed or enslaved any man who dared to enter their country without permission. Today, there are perhaps 1.5 million Lolos in these highlands. But as more and more Chinese have intermixed with them, there is less and less pure Lolo blood. Ask Lo Sang Chingdi.
That is our strength. There are many more of us white bones than there are black bones.
Ask Lo Sang Chingdi about General Ting.
General Ting is a Chinese. But he has taken the part of us white bones and the Watsi against the black bones.
This is my offer to you, black bones. You must obey the law. In return, I will protect you against your enemies in the other clans. I will expect you to pay taxes, as all other Chinese citizens do. And I will expect you to take orders from me and to carry out your rightful duties.
The black bones of my tribe knew about General Ting. They talked over what he said.
If General Tang's forces enters our country, we will deal with them as we have dealt with all other invaders.
General Tang has a strong army.
What army is equal to our fighters in the hills?
General Tang knows our hills. He grew up on the frontier. He knows our language. He has many white bones in his force.
What white bones?
Those that he promised freedom. Those that rose up against the black bones of the other clan.
Traitors! They are traitors.
General Tang has been wiser than we. He has promised them something.
I thought that he only supported the good clans against those that were brigands.
He does. With their help, he has crushed the rebellious clans.
You mean that if we do not accept his offer, he will march against us as rebels?
He will not only march against us, but he will turn the other clans against us.
We will not be intimidated by General Tang.
If we agree, he will let us keep our firearms. If we do not, after he has struck us with his force and with all the white bones who support him, he will disarm us and banish us to the wilderness.
The Blackbones talked about it for days. Then one day, one of General Tang's officers came for an answer.
You have until sundown. General Tang is waiting below in the valley with his force.
Why must he know by sundown?
Why cannot you give your answer now after all this time?
We will not give up without...
Wait. We can give our answer now. We can accept General Tang's offer. Or we can expect the same thing as has happened to the other clans that have resisted.
We will accept.
Very well. You will appoint a party to return with me to General Tang to act for you.
The next day, General Tang's force was in our village. And the day after that, all of us white bones were given firearms and called together to hear our black bone.
I ask loyalty of all of you to General Tang. You will march with him at once against the rebellious clan to the west. They have refused to yield, and General Tang, with our help, will crush them.
We marched through the canyons and the gorges.
The mountains in this country are 12 to 15,000 feet high, and as you can see, are partly covered with snow.
Most of the black bones rode horses, but most of us white bones and Watsi walked.
The Lolos moved like ferocious hordes through the rugged country.
Some of General Tang's soldiers wore uniforms, but most did not, and all of them were barefoot. Through the deep gorges, General Tang sent patrols ahead so the enemy could not catch us in a trap.
Do not get too far ahead of the main body. Keep in contact with us at all times. Go now.
Every Lolo knew the danger of the deep gorges between the high rocky precipices.
We marched this way for days. We knew we were getting close to the enemy black bones. Then, one night, when we were camped in a canyon eating our wheat, General Tang's colonel came into the clearing and talked to us.
Now, before dawn tomorrow, we will attack. Tonight, you will see that all your weapons are ready. Except those of you who are on guard. You can rest now for 3 hours. Then we will start moving in through the dark. Let me warn you now. The rebellious black bones know we are coming. And this is my last word to you. Do not permit yourselves to be captured.
None of us slept.
They will have guards out miles from their camp.
I think they have been watching us for days.
Why are we in this fight between the black bones? I do not want to fight.
Started creeping through the brush in the dark.
I can see nothing.
They are waiting for us.
They're getting close.
We felt our way up over the rocks as we crept.
They have discovered us.
Attack now. Show no quarter. Attack!
Went on until dawn.
Look, a whole party of them behind the boulder.
They are coming down after us.
Do not let them take us. Do not let them take us.
We did not let them take us. The three with me died. I was shot here. I was cut. General Tang's men saved me from being dragged away. The rebels were crushed. And General Tang took all the weapons from the rebellious black bones and sent the rebels far away into the mountains of the west.
In this way, by using one clan against the other, General Tang has put down the armed Lolo opposition to the Chinese government. But the resentment of the Lolos, even those who pay taxes to the government and, in a way, respect the government, is the same today against those who dare to enter their country without permission, as it has always been. They are either killed or made slaves. I have been among these people as a missionary for 30 years now. To some extent, I have come to understand them.
I know no other country but these mountains here in the bend of the Great River. I was born here. Who among my father's people in Chengdu would know or understand me, if any of my father's people in Chengdu are still living?
But as the Lolos are strong and fierce, they have not been able to make progress equal to that of the Chinese because of their feuds which go on for years, involving greater and greater numbers. Their stubborn pride, which keeps them from learning from others, and their superstitions, which tie them to ignorance.
Have you heard anything about Americans being held by Lolos anywhere in this mountain country?
No, I have not. But this Lolo land is a big country. As you see, there are few roads, no bridges, and almost no means of communication. So
you know about the bodies of three Americans brought out of this country and taken to Shanghai last September?
Yes, and we have heard about the recovery of the fourth body on Mount Liangbo.
But we've been informed that another plane, a Chinese National Airways ship, with an American pilot and about 30 others, crashed in this country in the early part of October.
I had heard nothing about that.
Well, in your opinion, if any of the crew members of these crashed planes survived, you think they're being held prisoner by the Lolos?
Well, I think the attitude of the Lolos toward those who enter their country without permission is the same today as it has been for hundreds of years. Look at Losang Chingdi here.
Losang Chingdi, where are you?
Here. Here, Lord.
Why are you here doing nothing? Do you forget so easily?
Listening to The Pacific Story, presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross currents of life in the Pacific Basin. Is written by Arnold Marquis. The music was scored and conducted by Henry Russell. The role of the missionary was played by Rolf Sedan. The role of Losang Chingdi was played by Sidney Miller. And now Gain Whitman has something of importance to say to you. Mr. Whitman?
During the war, tremendous strides were made in the advancement of science. Now that the war is over, we are entering the greatest scientific age of all time. In the forefront of this scientific research is the regular army, which today is training men to be highly skilled professionals in preventive medicine, in surgery and treatment, in jet propulsion, in mapping technique, in infrared viewing, in communications, and in many other fields. As never before, the U.S. Army is today training young men to be skilled technicians. This is your opportunity to prepare for a better future of peacetime living in the regular Army.
Programs in this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This program came to you from Hollywood. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.